Ladies and gentlemen, it happened. We finally got ourselves a book, but before we get too far into talking about this week's episode, I do, as always, want to give a big thank you to those of you who shared last week's video over on Twitter. So a big thank you to Similarity, Bubba Lubber, Luna Da Otaku, Arduin, and Matt87Eagle. Thank you all so much for sharing last week's video over on Twitter, and if you too would like to have your name shouted out in the next Bookworm video, then be sure to share this video around on the internet, and then tag me at JojoTalksToMuch over on Twitter, and I will be sure to shout out the first five of you in next week's video. Alright then, so what do you say we go ahead and get right into it? There's really two things to talk about this week. We can talk about creating the book, which did feel like it took an awfully long time. I don't just mean in this episode specifically, I mean how long it took to get here, but damn, was the journey worth it. Or we could talk about Wilma, or we can do what I'm gonna do and talk about both. Let's go ahead and talk about the creation of the book first, though. I feel like that's the thing that everybody's gonna want to talk about. So honestly, when we opened the episode, I was like kind of confused as to why everybody else was confused. Because mine opens by talking about the Three Little Pigs story. It's basically mine reading the kids the story of the Three Little Piggies. And we all know the story of the Three Little Pigs. Everybody gets read that as a kid. And it's a classic children's tale, just not here. Because there's an interesting dilemma that arises when mine reads to the kids the story. And that's that not only do the kids not know what a wolf or a pig is, neither does Wilma. And that's because I'm pretty much inclined to agree that they don't exist here. Like, just the way that they explain things, like, Wilma's like, I've never heard of that. So, one of two scenarios is going on. Either A, Wilma just has never seen a pig or a wolf, since she may have just been, like, within the church walls this whole time and may not be familiar with what that even is. Or, more likely, B, since this is an alternate fantasy world, they might just not exist, or if they do, they're called something else. So that might be the case. So maybe they just don't exist in this world, and that's why the story of the Three Little Pigs might get a little bit confusing. The most simple story on the planet, now confusing. Very interesting. But they do actually stumble onto a pretty nifty idea because of this, and this I found really interesting. So mine is now forced into this corner where she's like, okay, the stories that I read as a kid, like the kids' stories that normally are told, don't apply here because for all I know that these creatures and these things may not exist here, so it kind of renders the story moot if you don't know what the hell the thing being discussed in the book is even talking about. So mine is sort of pushed to this corner where now she has to think of something else. And then it just sort of drops in her lap the idea of, why don't we just take the holy scriptures and turn them into children's books? Condense these stories down so that a children could understand. That's really clever. And I really think that that's fantastic, right? Because I think given the nature of the story and given the current status of our characters, turning the scriptures into the children's book that they're trying to make is honestly probably the best bet, since this way, even if the church does get involved and say, like, she can't do that, at least she'll be able to say, but I'm making it to spread the good word, you know? Like, I'm trying to help everybody out. So it does make a hell of a lot of sense, both in narrative and in the overall scope of the show, since the whole point of this show, at least the reason why I got into it, and I know a lot of you got into it, was the fact that we just wanted to see mine make a dang book. That was like half the fun. And this episode very much is all about that, watching mine finally get to a point where she can make a dang book. And it's fun seeing all the different cast members like actually pull together and really try to get mine's book into their reality, like to finally make that dream physical. And we start even seeing like characters like Gil and Lutz, who I remind you were punching each other not that long ago. And even a lot of the orphans as well, running around helping mine fight off Trombe so that they can then take the sticks and use that to make the paper that mine needs for her books. It's really, really sweet, especially Lutz and mine. Lutz and Gil. Seeing Lutz and Gil specifically, like, hanging out and being buddy-buddy and chummy and everything, that did the old heart good. I liked seeing Lutz like take Gil under his wing, like, hey man, you got this. I'm gonna protect you, and like you're gonna help me, and in turn help mine, and that's how we're gonna get through things. And I'm interested to see the further development of the friendship between Gil and Lutz. Like, you know, like they're like Lutz needed, like Lutz has a friend in mind. He's got a friend in mind. Sorry, he has a friend in mind, but I think it's cool that he's actually developing friendships outside of mine, like even though they're still within mine's circle, of course. It's nice to see him like branch off. Like he has this like father-son dynamic going on with Benno, and now he has like a sort of brotherly dynamic going on with Gil. And Gil is a character who, you guys know, I'm not like, I can take or leave Gil. I'm not like the biggest Gil fan. But seeing this development for him, I was like, that's cool. I really liked seeing that. That was really lovely. Also, we have the downtown crew and the church actually gathering together to get Soot. And more specifically, we also see Wilma and Sig, which was a surprise. Sig, I had completely forgotten existed. This is Lutz's brother. And he actually does the woodwork based on Wilma's art in order to like paint over so that they can then use it as a stamp to make the books. That was really cool. I had never thought about that. I was curious as to how they were planning to get Wilma's drawing from page to page to page to page to page, unless they were just thinking that she was going to draw every single page, which would have been a total nightmare. So it was interesting to see like mine actually thinking about this already, like already thinking like we need a printing press, but I can't develop a printing press. So I guess we can use somebody who's good with wood, that being Sig, Lutz's brother, which I thought was a great way to sort of tie in Lutz's family slowly becoming more and more accepting of this merchant thing, because he's standing up for himself, even though that episode, as much as I like that episode, and I think it was the turning point, there is some stuff about it in hindsight that it's like, okay, well, but he, like, yeah, we're not here to talk about 2 episodes ago, we're here to talk about episode 8, not episode 6. So, yeah, I really liked seeing Sig as sort of a representation of Lutz's family, like, accepting that this is what Lutz wants to do. This eventually leads to them realizing that they need a more simpler version of the artwork in order to make the not only the woodworking easier, but also making the press easier as well. Like, too much detail in a sort of, like, stamp-like press is too complicated. You need smaller detail. So Wilma does just that, and we actually get to a point where we need Turi to bind the damn book together because, yeah, ladies and gentlemen, that's right, we made the book. Oh my god. We are into season 2, episode 8, or whatever episode overall we're on, even though, because Crunchyroll just has it as an overall thing, even though it's season 2. But regardless, we are now many episodes into the series, and we finally see Mine make her book, and we get this adorable little montage as well, seeing all the struggle that Mine's gone through in order to make the damn thing. And it really reminded me why I fell for the show so hard in the first place, finally seeing Mine the bookworm finally make her damn book. It was so sweet. I loved every part of this scene, seeing Mine finally get to make her book and like hold it in her hands with two of the people who she is closest with, Turi and Lutz. I ain't gonna lie to you guys, I started feeling the feels. I got a little bit emotional. It was quite lovely. I ain't gonna lie to you. Also, this is huge, actually. I have to talk about this now before we start talking about Wilma. There is a totally, absolutely no joke, brilliant scene with Ferdy of all characters. And you already know what I'm talking about. The scene between Ferdinand and Mine is the first step towards the very first scene of the very first episode. Ferdinand finally just calls it like he sees it. My boy Ferdy says, "What's up with you? Like, where are you actually from for real? Because there's no way. Everything that you do, it's, no, I refuse. You're not just some commoner kid. There's no way." And I was kind of floored for a second because I'm like, how did he know? But then I remembered, this is the same way that Lutz figured out, and this happens sometimes with Mine, where she gets too ahead of herself, like she gets too involved in what she's doing, she gets too excited about making the book, and then she gets cornered, and then somebody catches her and realizes, like, you know, she knows more than she should know. And so Ferdy just calls it like he sees it and says, like, hey, What the hell? And mine doesn't really have an answer. She does recall the one time the chef character, whose name I forget, says, like, how do you, like, where are you from for real? Like, how do you know all these? And mine, when Ferdy says, like, what was your answer? She comes back with, I saw all these things in a dream of a world that I can't go back to. And she says, like, do you believe me? And Ferdy just says, like, you're a god-awful liar. Like, he's just honest, right? He's like, you're a shit liar. Like, you're bad at lying. And the fact that I know you're lying and that you are definitely not from around here, we'll say, just raises even further questions. And Ferdy is just, like, already, like, I don't got time. Ain't nobody got time for this. You just go make your book. I'll figure out what to do later. This is a huge development. I don't know where they're going to go with this. Like, this, we always knew that this was going to happen, that Ferdinand was going to figure out who mine really was. Like, who, like figure out that mine is actually some girl named, like, I don't even remember her name anymore, like Arano or something. Because she's been mine to us for such a long time that you almost forget occasionally, especially because the show's writing hasn't been really on point. They just turned mine into a 7-year-old for no friggin' reason. But you forget that she's actually a adult from a totally different world. Sometimes that can get lost in the shuffle when you're just trying to watch mine build a dang book. And so she finally gets too ahead of herself. I like that it's her own excitement that gets the better of her, and that's what gets her caught by Ferdinand. It's not that she turns to Ferdinand and, like, tells him, like, hey, yeah, I'm not from around here. It's that she gets caught. I really, really dig that, because it also sort of harkens back to when she first got caught by Lutz. It's really neat. And also, there's amazing use of shadow in this scene. Brilliant use of shadows to really sort of, and like, really soft music. It's not, like, ominous. It's just soft for this really, like quiet but really intense and dramatic scene. Like, really, really brilliant scene. Can't stress enough how much I liked this. But before we wrap up the video, I do want to talk about the other big thing in the episode. I want to talk about Wilma. Now, Wilma, at the beginning of the episode, sort of thanks Mine for understanding and respecting her fears. And that's because, as we learned in the last episode, Wilma has a aversion towards men. Because a man treated her wrongly, we'll say. Now, the show heavily implies something else. Book fans were incredibly quick to tell me, like, no. I don't care. I don't read the freaking book. So, I don't care. Like, in the show, it heavily hints that she was in a predicament, we'll say. Which is sad. It's horrible. Whether or not it happened or not, it's sad, and it sucks, and you hate to see it. And it actually, like, now normally, I'm very hesitant when a series tries to tackle a topic as touchy as this, because it's not always done, shall we say, tastefully. But in this case, I really do think it only strengthened Wilma as a character to have this sort of tragic backstory that is incredibly real, and yet at the same time, not something that she just gets over. Even by the end of the episode, when we see her leave, it's not so much that she gets over it as much as she is trying to face her fears head on. And she will falter and she will fall, but she's gonna keep trying. And it's one of the reasons why I really like Wilma. Rosina and Wilma, I think, are the best retainers. They're the ones that surprised me the most. They're the ones that seem to have the most character. I really like those two the most. And I loved this. I shouldn't say I loved, because it's more like I thought the scene was really good. Where one of the orphans, like, reaches out for Wilma to say, like, hey, you should come with us to, like, the I forget what it is, like, to the shop, basically, where they make the books. Like, you should come with us to the, you should come with us to the whatever. And when the kid grabs her arm, it's more like she grabs around her wrist, and she has this quick, like, really sudden sort of flashback to the man who hurt her. And it's just fast enough that she pulls her hand back and it startles the kid, and the kid falls, and then the kid starts to cry, because obviously the kid's like, Wilma just knocked me over and I don't know why. And when you're a kid, obviously that's really upsetting. You start to cry because that's all you know how to do. And Wilma, like, bless her, she tries to help the kid back up, but then she sees all the looks from the other kids, like, being like, whoa, what was that? And she just apologizes and then bolts. And it's totally human. It's such a brilliant scene. that's immediately followed up by Wilma like getting fired up and like really determined when Mind says like, okay, so the previous art, it's great, but unfortunately it's so detailed that it sort of comes lost in translation by the time we transfer it over to the pages. So I tried to make something more like this, but it's not as good. Like basically Mind saying like, I need you to master a more simplified version of your current artwork. And like Wilma tackles this with like total determination and she gets really fired up. And I think it's part of her wants to make up for what she did with the kids. Wilma loves these damn kids. Like Wilma is really like queen of the orphanage. Like she really loves these kids. So the idea that she made one of them cry obviously sticks with her and really bugs her. So she gets determined and fired up to make a, like to start making the artwork to give these kids some sort of gift as a maybe a sort of apology, but also to find the inner strength in herself to actually leave the orphanage and go outside, which she does by the end of the episode. Wilma is fantastic, like an absolutely brilliant character. Loved her to pieces, and I really loved this episode, if you couldn't tell. With that said though, everybody, I'm going to wrap up my thoughts here. Question of the day today: who is your favorite retainer so far? I think if I had to pick, as much as I love Wilma, I would probably say Rosina. But who's your favorite retainer? Let me know in the comments. And with that said, we've reached the end of the video, so I hope you guys enjoyed it. If you did, then don't forget to boop the up snoot and share if you care. And if you want to see me rambling even more, then feel free to follow me on Twitter or join our good folks Discord, both of which are linked in the doobly-doo. Lastly, if you're feeling generous, consider checking out our Patreon page to help support this channel. Speaking of which, I'd like to give a big thank you to our lovely patrons, such as iZevy, Alex, Andrew W, Branson C, Calvin A, Crowbar of Irony, Daniel G, Deep Not That Deep, Digger the Fox, Dominic G, Emily, Ionos, Urza, Ginkotaku, Godzilla Fan, No For Nothing, Maria T, Marshall B, Mater, Mirth Mouser, Nymad, Cell, Shadow Creative, Stephen G, The Suavest Orange, Tristan G, and Veridin. Thank you all so much for your continued support over on Patreon, and once again, thank you for checking out today's video. Hope you guys have a lovely day, and until next time, you stay classy, AnnieTube, and wash your dang hands.